Hi, I'm Louise Cohen. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of the Primary Care Development Corporation, which is an organization that has been headquartered in New York, but we work nationally. And I just want to acknowledge that we have at least, I think, three board members in the room. We have Gary Jacobs, we have Waria Esmond, and Don Ashkenaz over here. If I've missed anybody, let me know. So please feel free to come and talk to talk to any one of us about PCDC. So this is an innovation circle. It's one of a series of fora that PCDC does on a regular basis to try to raise conversation about primary care and what's happening in the world. Our program today will last about 90 minutes, and it will include questions from the audience at the end. And then we'll, as I said, we'll have a chance to get together and have some refreshments and time to talk. But before we begin, I'd like to introduce someone who's really important for us, which is our sponsor for the evening, Dennis O'Connell, who's the director at Custom Computer Specialists, and we really appreciate your sponsorship and bringing us all here to Long Island. So thank you.
Thanks, Louise. Very, very happy to have everyone here. Been working with PCDC for the last couple of years. Really great organization. Events like this, kind of sharing, collaborating, really important for us. I'm going to tell you a little about Custom Computer. We are a technology support organization for healthcare organizations. I run a healthcare division there. Three things that we kind of do to kind of remember what we're doing. We support close to 200 different primary care locations throughout the New York metro area. The kind of support we provide, we support 33 different EMRs. All right, so we're doing everything from upgrades to support to help desk to just maintaining the systems. All right, typically it's an area that most of these organizations need a lot of help for because they don't have the type of support that a large hospital might have. So we're really kind of in the trenches helping them out there. The second area where we help organizations is around innovation. Some of the areas where we're innovating is around telehealth right now. Having conversations how we can take telehealth and bring it out to schools and marry the other side of my organization along with the healthcare organizations and really get traction out to the edge. How do we get behavioral health involved? We're doing that with a nursing home right now where they've got to ship their people, throw them in an ambulance, drive them out to go see their psychologist, just so they can keep their meds every day. But now we're connecting them so that we're helping them to, you know, ease the care, ease the pain of that transition to movement for the end users. And the third area where we really help organizations, you know, large hospitals, financial organizations have huge IT security staffs. We have a very deep security staff from working with the hospitals that we leverage and drive down into the organizations to help them identify risk, help them develop their risk assessments that a lot of places haven't put together, and then help put together programs that match their appetite for spending. You know, you could always spend as much as you want, but how do you get out in front of the ransomware and things like that? So at the end of the day, IT support organization, think about how, you know, we might be able to help any one of you or anyone, a friendly organization. But I'm really happy to get this program started. I'll turn it back over to Louise.
Great. Thank you very much. I also want to just briefly say that we have a corporate circle, and our corporate circle sponsors are really important to us. We are really important partners and collaborators. And so in addition to Custom Computer Specialists, we have Athena Health, Affinity Health Plans, Lindenwood Rx, Manat, Proskauer, Crystal & Company, Altruista Health, Rifkin Radler, and Goldman Sachs. So thank you all for the work that you do. So we're going to get started. So we're here tonight to talk about primary care, the Affordable Care Act, and new and potential Trump administration policies affecting primary care. To step back, PCDC believes that primary care is transformational and is a cornerstone of healthy, thriving communities. We believe that primary care is essential to individual health and to community health, and it is specifically the first contact with the healthcare system, care throughout the life cycle from newborn to end-of-life care. It's non-disease specific, it's patient-centered. It encompasses physical health, women's health, oral health care, behavioral health. And to reach its promise, we believe that primary care must be accessible, high quality, affordable, culturally competent, and reimbursed fully. On March 23rd, 2010, then President Obama signed into law the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, known as the ACA or Obamacare. It is often thought of as primarily insuring folks, and it indeed did that for approximately 30 million people around the country, but it also encompassed consumer protections, increased access to care, supported public health, and improved quality of care. And as you are all well aware, the new Trump administration has begun to implement campaign promises in a wide variety of areas, including policies on immigrants and refugees, education, the environment, and homeland security, which are all important, all of concern, and frankly, we believe all impact public and population health. But tonight, we're going to be focusing on the potential impact of Trump administration policies on healthcare, with a special focus on primary care writ large, starting with the particular promise of the Trump campaign, which was to repeal and replace the ACA. So we have with us tonight five health policy experts and practitioners. Their bios are in your program, so please do take a look. I won't talk all about them, but we have Deb Bachrach from Anat Health, Ann Nolan from HRH Care, Christy Parquet from the Coalition for Behavioral Health, Dr. Reuven Pasternak, who is the CEO of Stony Brook University Hospital, I always get that wrong, and State Senator Ken Pannon. So thank you all for being here. You all have very different perspectives, and I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say tonight. Along the way, in addition to hearing what all our panelists have to say about what they believe will be policies and the impact, we'll also be talking about ways in which we can work on policies that we think will promote primary care, which is very important. But let me set the stage briefly. So over the past 6 years, the Affordable Care Act has supported primary care in important ways. It has increased health insurance coverage, so 20 to 30 million people covered through new health insurance or retaining health insurance. The elimination of out-of-pocket costs for preventive services such as contraception, vaccinations, and Medicare annual wellness visits. Addressing chronic disease through clinical and preventive, clinical and community prevention services. Programs to improve the health of people with multiple behavioral health issues and chronic diseases. Encouraged integrated systems of care, systems of primary care providers in addition to other providers to support higher quality and to rationalize reimbursement and workforce loan repayment and training programs. It increased reimbursement to high quality primary care providers through a variety of mechanisms. There was $11 billion over 5 years in community health center funding to support federally qualified community health centers, operations and facility expansion. Through the Center for Medicaid and Medicare Services Innovation Program and other funding streams, there was a promotion of reimbursement and delivery system reform, commonly called value-based payment, which emphasizes outcomes, patient-centeredness, care coordination and management, especially for higher acuity and higher cost patients. It expanded the reach of the mental health parity laws in significant ways. It incentivized the widespread use of electronic health records to support effective data sharing and to improve health. And there was a growing understanding of public health and primary care, particularly as it relates to the social determinants of health. However, even with these fundamentally important primary care gains, there remains, in PCDC's views, some significant challenges which have impacted primary care substantially historically and which the ACA did not necessarily fully resolve. The first one is insufficient resources that go to primary care. So primary care gets about 5 cents on the healthcare dollar, and we think that this is insufficient when you think about what primary care is asked to do in this environment that we're now in. There are fairly onerous reporting requirements. One recent study said that over $50,000 per primary care FTE is just spent on reporting, and that's reporting to various insurance companies, to government programs, and so forth. There are many, many innovation projects. So while we support the fact of the idea of innovation, in fact, for primary care providers, there's a huge amount of noise in the system, and many of them can't figure out how to handle all the many programs that are out there and to be successful at them. There is a continuing capital funding focus on hospitals over primary care. So for example, the DSRIP capital program, in which approximately $1.3 billion went to hospitals, admittedly some for their ambulatory care centers, and approximately $150 million to primary care, which included federally qualified health centers and private providers. And in next year's budget, with all due respect and thank you to Senator Hannon, out of $500 million of capital for healthcare facility transformation, only $75 million is designated for community health care, and that's not only primary care, but behavioral health and other community-based services as well. We think primary care faces an insufficient primary care workforce, so not only physicians, but mid-level providers, including nurses and physician assistants. And we know that there remains uneven clinical quality among even our best primary care providers. There's an inadequate provision of women's reproductive health services in ambulatory care settings across our state, and there's high rates of ambulatory care-sensitive conditions that still mean far too many people get hospitalized and have adverse events due to diabetes, hypertension, asthma, things that we know can be controlled through effective outpatient care. So in the next 4 to 8 years, with a very different federal landscape, we must now ask the question, what will the new federal administration's policies on primary care be? So tonight we're going to be looking at what we know today, what we think might happen, and we're going to follow the story and the issues that we think are of importance as the next period unfolds. So with that, I would like to turn things over to Deb Bachrach. We're going to start with a presentation by Deb or discussion about some of the key issues. And then we're going to have each panelist will say a few words about their particular area of expertise. And then I'm going to have a little bit of a moderated conversation. And then we're going to invite some questions and comments from you all. And we hope that this is the beginning and not the end of our dialogue. So let's get started.
Thank you, Louise. It's a pleasure to be here. So I'm going to try to sit while I talk because I'm about to tell you what's going on in Washington. And it's very hard for me to talk about that sitting down. So first of all, I'm not going to say the word primary care ever again. All I'm going to talk about is health insurance coverage because Louise said this. I think we all believe this. Without coverage, that's our starting point. If we don't have individuals don't have health insurance coverage and providers don't have reimbursement, we can't really talk about providing preventive care and primary care. So I want to talk about coverage, and I want to talk about the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, and what it means to repeal and replace it, or what the Republicans in Congress mean when they talk about repeal and replace it. And I want to talk about the implications, and I'm going to keep coming back to the repeal and replace bill, which is the AHCA, the American Healthcare Act. So let's get started. As Louise said, 24 million people gain coverage through the Medicaid expansion and through the marketplaces. And in the marketplaces, qualified health plans, right? So that's 24 million, about half through Medicaid and half through QHPs, qualified health plans, 24 million people. And the AHCA effectively undoes it. And let's talk about what it does. So the two pieces I want to look at, first and briefly, because it's not my area of expertise, let's talk about the individual market. In New York, there are 250,000 people enrolled in qualified health plans. And 60% rely on subsidies. Now, there are two kinds of subsidies, and these are critical. And 60% of that 250,000 people rely on it. Everyone, that's 650,000 people who are enrolled in the Essential Health Plan or Basic Health Plan for individuals with incomes below 200% of the federal poverty, rely on subsidies. There's no Essential Health Plan without the subsidies. 60% of the people in the marketplace can't afford coverage without the subsidies. So what are those subsidies? Two things, both at risk. There's premium tax credits or advanced premium tax credits, and that helps people pay the premium. So that is calculated based on your income and the cost of the plan in your region. So if your income is below 250%, you get more than if your income is between 250 and 400% of the federal poverty level. So what does the AHCA does? It reduces it. It's no longer will it be tied to income. No longer will it be tied to the cost of the plan in your area. It will be a fixed amount, substantially less than it is now. And that's only the subsidy to buy coverage, to pay the premium. The one more thing, insidious proposal, not that I have an opinion, I'm very neutral, is that it changes the age rating. In the ACA, You can't charge older people more than three times as much as younger people. That changes to 5-1. So somebody over 50 is going to pay a lot less, assuming they can buy it at all, because in theory they can buy it, but the resources won't be there. Now, for our lowest income folks, those below 250% of the federal poverty level, not only does the Affordable Care Act help pay for the premium, it also reduces their deductible and cost sharing, because, you know, deductibles are a killer these days. And for our most modest income folks, those below 250, under the Affordable Care Act, they get a cost sharing reduction. Now, no cost sharing reductions at all in the AHCA, none. And they're already at risk because of a lawsuit that the Trump administration has not decided whether to continue to challenge. We lost in the lower court. The Obama administration appealed it. It's suspended at the moment, and we are waiting to hear whether the Trump administration will continue cost sharing reductions. If they decide not to continue it, the individual market will implode. If they decide not to continue it, individuals with incomes below 250% of the federal poverty level will not be able to afford coverage. That's what's at risk in the individual market. So think about it for New York. If we get rid of the cost-sharing subsidies, because everyone in our essential plan, all 650,000 of them, get cost-sharing reductions and subsidies to help them buy premiums. It's those dollars that fund our essential health plan. It's those dollars that the AHCA is pulling out. Not all of them, just most of them. So that's about, and so then we have 60% of the folks in our individual market. Same thing, we're pulling out the subsidies. So that's about a million people that are at risk right now. Now let's turn to Medicaid, which is my passion. If you read my bio, you know I was Medicaid director in New York up until 2010. So I really am a complete Medicaid groupie. So, Medicaid. Right, Kemp? I know. I know. Kemp and I have a long history. So Medicaid was the foundation of the continuum of coverage in the Affordable Care Act. And it was the Medicaid expansion, which became optional because of the Supreme Court decision. But it said all states could expand their Medicaid program, so adults with incomes up to 138% of the federal poverty level would be covered by Medicaid, with the federal government paying at least 90% of the costs. 31 states chose to expand. New York chose to expand. So 31 expanded, 19 did not. For New York, that expansion, because we were considered what's called a leader state, this is one of my most proud actions, is I helped negotiate this, because we ensured that the leader states that had already expanded coverage to childless adults and parents to at least the poverty level, would essentially be bought out. We did the right thing. Other states got the money to let them expand, so they gave it to us too, not originally, but in the end, and it bought it out. So when I talk about the Medicaid expansion being at risk, this is what's at risk for New York. It's the dollars and cents that support coverage today, and the question will become, when the federal government pulls it out, will we have the money in our budget, billions of dollars, to replace it? So let's talk about what happened. Medicaid expansion, and I know we want to talk about primary care and value-based purchasing, but what the Medicaid expansion did, it was the final step in moving Medicaid from the welfare space to the health insurance space. It provided the platform, the incentive, the motivation for Medicaid directors around the country to look at their job as providing value-based care for their enrollees. So we weren't a small welfare program. We were demanding high-quality, cost-effective care. And it changed everything. It has Medicaid directors in the forefront of integrating physical and behavioral health, in the forefront of integrating social determinants. But it was done not because the time was right. The time was right because our the low-income folks for whom we were responsible now had continuous coverage. And remember, it also made it easier for people to get on and stay on, which is equally important. That is all flows from the Medicaid expansion and the provisions of the Affordable Care Act. Okay, 31 states expanded, 14 million people are in that expansion group. Expansion states in 16 received $72 billion. That's just to support federal dollars supporting expansion adults. $72 billion built into state budgets. New York share, $8 billion, just related to the Medicaid expansion. So what does Congress now propose to do with that? First, it says if your state didn't expand by March 1st of 2017, you can't expand. Okay, so forget the 19 states. They missed the boat. They're out. Okay. If you expanded, you're fine, except New York. The leader states got a little tweak down right away on their match. So right away, we're going to screw the leader states a little bit. That's New York, Arizona, Delaware, Vermont, Massachusetts. You get the picture. So we're pulling out a few percentage points of the coverage right away from the leader state provisions. Then for the rest of us, including New York, all 31 states, as of December 31st, 2019, anyone else that comes into expansion, you get regular match. The only people for whom you can now get your enhanced match, your 90% match in New York's case instead of 50, right, is individuals who are enrolled as of December 31st, 2019 and don't drop coverage for more than 30 days. So past experience says 50% will drop coverage by the end of year one. So the state can say, we're not doing it anymore, and many states will say, sorry, we don't have the money. New York, that's going to be a harder decision to say because we have a history of coverage. So we come up with the $8 billion, or we say, once you're out of the expansion adult group, sorry, we can't cover you anymore. So after January 1 of 2020, no more expansion dollars, no more enhanced federal dollars. And just to be sure that people will fall off, there's a new requirement that says you have to recertify eligibility every 6 months. So that's going to make it more likely. So the data that says after 1 year, 50% will fall off was the old days when we only required people to renew coverage or reprove eligibility every year. So now we have to do it every 6 months. So that's what happens with the expansion. Now think about this. The churning goes up, coverage goes down, primary care, forget it. Unless, of course, you're a state that can find the additional dollars to cover. That means, in other words, instead of 90% federal dollars, take it down to whatever your regular match is. New York, it's 50%. Okay, so that's expansion. Pretty much at risk by CBO says within 10 years only 5% of the original group is on. That's part one. Now we go to the proposals to cap Medicaid funds. Now this doesn't have to be in repeal and replace. This Medicaid financing provision has been a long favorite of Congressman Ryan, and it's in. Oh, I want to say one other thing before I get to cap funding. There's another one of my favorite provisions. I'm up. This one deserves a walk around, folks. Over 10 years, the AHCA pulls $840 billion out of Medicaid. And what does it do with it? It underwrites repealing the taxes in the ACA. So it is genuinely pulling $840 billion out of healthcare for low-income Americans in order to fund tax relief for other Americans. We get rid of the tax on tanning salons, on durable medical equipment, on Medicare for higher-income people. But it's okay because we can fund it out of $840 billion in tax cuts, in Medicaid cut. So that's, and the Cadillac tax, but not right away. Cadillac tax is late. But it is true, $84 billion a lot of taxes go away. Cadillac tax has been one of the more controversial across party lines, if you will. Okay. So that's what happens to our $840 billion. Now let's talk about capping Medicaid funding. Whether or not the AHCA comes back, I promise you capped funding is coming back. And here's what's insidious. Right now, the way Medicaid works is the state spends more money on a service or adds a benefit, the federal government will match it at the state's matching rate, so long as the state follows federal rules. And in New York, in every state, you're very careful. You follow the federal rules because you want those federal matching dollars. So it's in a sense, we're talking about an entitlement program for states, right? This is what capped funding does. First of all, talk about the intent. What's the intent of capped funding? From the federal perspective, they want budget certainty and they want to save money. So how do they do that? They do it by setting a cap on the federal dollars that will be available to each state. And you can do it in one of two ways. You can cap it in the aggregate, so states are at risk for higher enrollment and higher costs. New York State, you get $40 billion, live and be well. If you need 42, you know, fund it yourself. Or they can do it on a per cap basis, on a per enrollee basis. And the major provision in the AHCA is a per cap provision. The eligibility groups are children, adults, elderly and disabled. So it's non-elderly and disabled adults. Those are our categories. And you look at a 2016 base year, you apply a trend to 2019, you do a little bit of adjustment, and that's your capped amount going forward. So you can spend no more, let's say, New York than $4,000 on children, $14,000 on the elderly, $12,000 on the disabled. And then it's trended every year. The trend rate is medical CPI, Consumer Price Index, the medical component for children and adults, and medical CPI plus one for elderly and disabled. Then it's all aggregated, and the state can use the dollars any way they want. Here's the thing to be careful of. You look at medical CPI as the trend, certainly medical CPI plus one. Most states' trend is below that. So it's deceiving. You say to yourself, looks okay, right? When I trended and we model it and we did that. But once we're capped, once Medicaid is capped, that means the next time Congress comes back and needs to save a little money, how easy is it to say, we'll do medical CPI minus one this year? Once we're in a capped environment, we are susceptible to the budget cutters in a way we're not today. What's more, once we're in a capped environment, we cannot respond to the new cure, the new drug that cures Hep C, that cures Alzheimer's, that cures breast cancer. What if it's expensive? What about the new gene therapies? There's no room in there to deal with it. What about the next 9/11 or the next Hurricane Katrina or the opioid epidemic? There's no elasticity in a cap. And that's the problem with it. It changes the nature of the program dramatically. So the cap proposal in New York has the interesting little Collins-Faso provision, which also says that if you're a state that raises money from counties, now many states raise money from counties, but it's worded such that it only applies to New York. I won't give you the minutiae. But if it's raised from the counties, it can't be matched in calculating the cap. So our cap goes down just a little bit more. It doesn't say counties can't be made to put money in, by the way. It just says the federal government won't match it. So this, our state's cap goes down. Little zinger for us in New York. Okay. So I'm just about done, which is good because my time is just about up. 2 minutes, doing this very well. Couple of other things. I know what's the thing.
We're just waiting for the optimistic side.
Oh, no. I'm just looking. I also want to tell you there's the defunding provision in there that defunds Planned Parenthood. So that's in addition to what came out today, which is for Title X funding. States no longer have to give any money to Planned Parenthood. It's not about abortion. Medicaid doesn't fund abortion. Title X doesn't fund abortion. This is about Planned Parenthood. So that's in there too. So that's, and it's, it, will it come back? Won't it come back? I don't know. You can read the papers as well as I can. I think it may well come back, but I don't know. CAP funding will come back. That much I feel pretty confident about. The last piece, which is even if it doesn't come back, we have to watch CHIP reauthorization. CHIP sunsets on October 1 of 2017. By the end of the year, states will run out of CHIP dollars. So CHIP comes back. It becomes the vehicle to attach a lot of this to. Will it? I don't know. But the other thing to watch when you're worrying about the New York FISC is the CHIP provision has a 23% bump in the federal match for CHIP. So our normal CHIP match was 65%, a little bit better than Medicaid. 2 years ago, that went up by 23 percentage points. There, that 23 percentage points is at risk in the CHIP reauthorization. So we have to worry about that as well. So it's not a pretty picture if you believe in coverage. If you believe in tax cuts, a little better. But in coverage, we have a problem. Thanks.
All right. So there's a lot of questions to be asked, but I'm going to turn it over to Ann Kaufman Nolan, who is the CEO of HRH Care.
Thank you, Louise. Thanks, Deb. I don't envy myself following you. you're seamless. No, you just keep talking beautifully about really a lot of content, and I appreciate that content, much of which I have to say aligns with that very, very closely. But let me just first put it in the Community Health Center FQHC perspective, a little bit about what's going on in the country. You probably do know this, that community health centers, federally qualified health centers, see 25 million people in the United States, and that's in 10,000 communities. In New York State, we have 2 million patients being served in community health centers in 650 communities, and here in Long Island and in the Hudson Valley, HRH Care serves 176,000 patients, one of the largest health centers in the country, serving 76,000 people in the Hudson Valley. And with our partners, LIFQHC and the Developmentally Disabled Community Providers here in Long Island, 100,000 patients. So our perspective is, I think, one that I'm trying to relay today that really has a bit of an impact on everyone. I think that health centers around the country have been a big bipartisan supported entity. And through that bipartisan support over the years, we've been able to see that kind of growth that that occurred, which was doubling the size during George Bush administration, George W., doubling our size again in the Obama administration. The $11 billion set aside in the health trust that Louise talked about was to really set up and put in place the foundation for the expansion of Obamacare, for the expansion of service delivery through new access points and expanded services so that our target population of the uninsured, underinsured, and Medicaid would have access to the best quality health services. So when I'm highlighting the role of Medicaid and the same program issues that you've highlighted, Deb, I mean, it has substantial impact on our community health centers. Nearly 50% of the people we serve are in the Medicaid program, covered by Medicaid, and up to 54, 55, sometimes higher percent of our total revenue is Medicaid revenue and CHIP revenue added into that. A rollback of Medicaid expansion for us, when we're looking at our own system, we're talking of thousands, but not nearly what you think about. 3 million patients were added in to other community, all around the country, to community health centers, and I know our state health centers absorbed a significant percentage, but as Deb was describing, the Medicaid expansion wasn't as expansive in New York. We already had a lot of people in the system. So nationally, there was a 14% increase in patients coming into community health centers covered under the Medicaid expansion, while they're in New York State, at least in our case, it was around 7%. Thanks to the state, that's the difference in what expanded coverage meant as a state going forward into the Medicaid expansion. There's one aspect that, as I always, whenever I get a chance, I'd like to just, I'm sure there are many myths, and Deb and I traveled around the country at one point to talk to Medicaid directors and local departments of health and others as we did some survey work years ago. Deb was the only attorney in New York that our fellow PHSP colleagues could agree on as our attorney. And so that's how the coalition of PHSPs was formed, and I was the first chair. And so Deb and I traveled for 3 years really benchmarking a lot of services and programs and Medicaid that was going on in the country. But unique to community health centers, if you haven't heard about PPS, the reimbursement, the prospective payment system in community health centers, has been the strength and offered the stability to community health centers for years. And that delivery of the package of services that are provided, the coverage in New York has been embraced. And in New York is not seen as the villain. However, around the country, PPS takes quite a hit. Medicaid directors everywhere as part of the club are not so thrilled with PPS. And so anytime, and governors as well, and there's been governors association letters and other, every time we seem to be pointed out as something exceptional and maybe not frugal, and that's why we have this PPS reimbursement. On the other hand, just the total opposite. This is the way that we're able to provide services and not take limited federal dollars from our federal funding, which is 10% of our budget, not 54 to 56% of our total revenue, and use those dollars directly, making sure that our Medicaid patients are well supported in fair payment is a method for us to be able to continue to put our federal subsidies and our state uncompensated care dollars towards the care for the uninsured, of which 30% of our patients are in that category of uninsured and pay on a sliding fee scale, and that's based on income and family size. So that's just a little education about the importance of PPS, because it's implicated in these changes, as I think, as we move along. But you can always weigh in on that. I'm really interested in everybody else's thought on that. But I think that the rollback of Medicaid expansion, the per capita caps and or block granting, the PPS fair payment, and our federal 330 funding, that $3.6 billion of the $5.1 is also in that same timeline of MACRA having been approved 2 years ago that extends through the end of September, is up for renewal at that point. And that's a bit scary to have 70% of community health center operational funding at risk, in large part due to the expansion during the Obama administration. Under when we talked about the billions of the $11 billion that was put in, it was to grow the system and to operate the system. And so with those new sites and those new access points and the new services we've added and the millions of patients we've added to the system, it's going to be hard to say goodbye to 70%, even if it is a smaller percentage of budget than Medicaid. Just to finish off, because I can see that I have like no minutes left, a couple notes on the per capita cap or block granting. The competition for the dollar, we feel, would be so fierce in this environment. It can create a real food fight amongst our safety net providers. It's less money in the system. As Deb pointed out, the ability to transform is hindered by less money. For example, as much as some people hit on DSRIP, I won't, my colleague is sitting in the panel with me, we have had good experience in the district systems with the transformation that occurs. We believe that when you put money into transformation, it can occur. Now, we could disagree with whether it's top-up or bottom-up, but in any case, I think that we believe that without any transformation dollars, that it really inhibits a reform of where we want to go in our direction. The one last point I'd like to make is about the FQHC's bad rap about not wanting to participate in value-based payment, and I know her mouth may fall open because she spent a lot of time trying to work an alternative payment methodology that one would find acceptable in New York State. I guess just the point that the time wasn't right, and it certainly is in relationship to per capita caps or block granting. What we need to do and what we intend to do through pilots and through our own involvement in value-based payment is we want to work and be given the opportunity to work in creating an understanding of a base reimbursement, of a floor from which to build with our PPS rates that help to establish that floor with the services that we provide as part of that package. And so I think that is a huge opportunity, if things don't fall apart before, for us to really work in a state like New York with a commissioner who's not negative about this at all and actually has challenged us to come forward with models of value-based payment and an alternative payment methodology. And so we're going to jump on that and move ahead. So thank you.
Thanks, Ann. So I think your point is really well taken, that with a per capita cap, now you have a different kind of competition among the healthcare providers. You know, if primary care today gets 5 cents on the dollar, what will happen to primary care under that scenario? So our next speaker is Christy Parquet, who's newly the CEO of the Coalition for Behavioral Health.
Great. Okay. So, wow, following after these fantastic folks. So I have a little bit of a different perspective, but it's an important perspective because we're talking about integration. And between behavioral health, which is substance use mental health services, into the physical health world. And one thing I always try to let people know is that in our sector, I think we all agree with that. I don't think there's any particularly, you know, view that we are against that. That integration is there. We understand that it's vital because from a perspective of delivering services, you have to do a holistic perspective view. So you're starting where the patient, the client, the participant, the program, you start where they're at. And so I think that I always like to let people know that on the behavioral health side, that we understand that integration is integral to the healthcare, to the behavioral healthcare of the people that we're serving, and more importantly, to the communities that we're serving. So one of the things that I wanted to say is that looking at what's been happening with on the federal level, there's a concern about what would be happening to our ability to address the health of our communities and the health of the individuals we're serving. So we're making, you know, since we've had Medicaid expansion, there's so much at risk. Now, it has not been easy. I will tell you, it continues to not be easy. But what I will tell you is that the sector embraces these changes that have happened under the expansion. But there's a few things you need to know about the sector that we're at, which I think somebody asked about a positive spin. I don't know where he's at, but I'm gonna take the positive spin a little bit, or just make you feel better. So the community-based nonprofit sector, which I represent, they're fighters. They're driven. Some might say they're martyrs, which is a little bit of a problem with some of our business practice models, which we're evolving, which I'll go into. But we are, we're first responders. Some might say reactive, but we think of ourselves as first responders. We know what's going on in our communities. And on the downside, we're a little bit risk averse for good reason, because we know what's at risk in our communities. So that is actually a positive spin, because you have a whole bunch of fighters on the side to make sure that the gains and the strides that we've made, particularly around substance use and mental health. And also, I want to talk about stigma. Stigma around mental health, stigma around substance use, and this idea that recovery is possible, that parity is important, is an important part of physical health. We have to have the flowing between these communities, because when you have somebody in your family, you don't you don't see that person as this is their mental health and their substance use. Who do you go to? People, your first crisis, you're going to go to whoever you feel comfortable with. And that's the front door. Any door should be the open entry for people to be addressed, whether it be diabetes care at a clinic, a behavioral health clinic, or somebody dealing with substance use issues at their primary care doctor. So the good news for this crowd is that you have a whole bunch of providers who are fighters, who are on board with finally really seeing, hey, we can treat our communities and the clients that we serve from a holistic perspective. So that's the good news for the gentleman over there. So hooray for that. And I'll tell you also, I'm a community organizer. So we can organize our community. We can fight for these things. These are really important. So I do, you know, I want to start out with a positive piece of it. The populations that we serve sometimes are seen as part of the high cost problem. But I also think we're part of, when you think of it from a population health perspective, we're part of the a generation of solutions. So that if we can look at things like social determinants and be able to address poverty, then we have the ability to really long-term, beyond 4 years, somebody's term in office, but really long-term look at what we can do around generations of poverty. And what we've seen historically in this country, you know, just talking a little bit about poverty, is that when we changed welfare reform laws in 1996-97 under the Welfare Reform Act, what we've seen since then is very deep poverty. We saw poverty, but now we see, statistically speaking, deep poverty growing too. So I think that we have a little background of what it's going to take to fight for services that we know keep people healthy and keep those communities healthy. So from the perspective of what's going on with all these changes, we have a lot at risk, particularly around the opioid and mental health arena. Now, I will say on the, in New York State, there's thankfully, thank you, Senator, for your support around the $200 million for helping us fight the opioid crisis in New York. But $214 million. And trust me, I would have fought for that $14 million. But we also have good news on the federal front, and I think there's an opportunity there to look at the 21st Century Cures Act, which was it took place in December, and it had been going on since fall, but it was a bipartisan effort mid-December, where it was a little bit of a kumbaya moment in Congress, which we have not had enough of those moments, where people on both sides of the aisle said that we want to, really push forward on the healthcare component of what this country can do, things related to cancer, but there was a discussion and an inclusion of addressing the opioid crisis in this country. And something to understand, too, is that when you look at the base of the people who are promoting these new ideas or methodology about what we're going to do with Medicaid, that is a base. Those people who are impacted by opioid and mental health issues, those communities, I'm not going to get into partisan politics, but we can eventually mobilize those folks because they have a lot at risk of losing services through Medicaid or resources related to addressing their loved one's addiction issue. So it's going to hit home pretty quickly of what would happen but for those services. We know in New York there's a lot of risk. We already, out in the city, we're more fortunate. The wait times are less for getting treatment or going into treatment for opioid or other substance use addiction or mental health services. But there's still, that's not true for children, but for substance use, I would say that's true. Outside of the city, we've been making strides on that. The state has made a commitment on that. I think that there's a risk there that I think that's one of the areas that we're very concerned about. And I would say around, particularly around substance use, we've talked about there's been an expansion of the protections or the idea of substance use and parity, and there's a lot at risk for that. And I don't think that on a federal level, there hasn't been enough talk about that. So CHIP, I agree. We're very concerned about CHIP. One thing to know is that in New York, we have about 37% of the people who are on Medicaid are children. That's a huge risk pool population. And if you know about adverse childhood experiences, we want to make sure that we're not taking away services for those kids, particularly the ones under 5. We are looking at suicide rates of young girls that are alarming, and also particularly in the Latino community, very alarming. But for mental health and substance use services, we risk these young people's lives. And where do they start to get those services? Where do their parents bring them? They bring them to the health clinics where they get services. And then, you know, we can work on doing referrals. But there's a huge risk to our younger generation around that. When you look at other special populations, particularly the LGBTQ young folks, they're 40% of them very high risk for suicide, particularly the boys. All these things are risk areas. However, we're very good at organizing those communities. And I think if we start talking more about the details of what does it mean if we take away those protections or the services we've been able to provide. Related to the sector that I represent, I want to talk a little bit about the areas that we're looking forward under expansion and then moving forward would be the areas of capacity, infrastructure, access in our workforce. And there's been a little bit of a cultural, I guess it's a cultural dissonance between, we're philosophically aligned with the idea of alternative payment models. The problem is we're not financially there yet. And part of it is that we've started the race a little bit late. And part of that has to do with how traditionally community-based programs have been funded, nonprofits have been funded. What does that model look like? And it's not for not wanting to have been fully funded in the last, 30 years, but it's because of the payment models that we've had to deal with. So that puts us, as we look at these alternative payment models, a little bit behind. It's not that we don't want it, it's that how do we get there? And so what that means is, what are the resources that prepared us for all these changing environments since we've had Medicaid reform and also looking at the expansion? And I think rightly so, my members, and there are some of them here, who would say we absolutely embrace this idea that we should be looking at outcomes. It's that is the most important metric because it helps us fulfill our mission, which is to create healthy individuals and strong communities. The problem has been, how are we resourced to be really successful in that? And I think, again, that we started the race a little bit late. We're not resourced to get to where we need to be. We're going to continue fighting that, Senator. And thank you for other additional supports. The Transformation Fund that you mentioned, the $75 million, will go a long way to help community-based organizations, both the clinics and the behavioral health folks. That being said, the biggest resource of all of our programs are the people that do that one-on-one relationship building with the people that they're serving, whether it be a home and community-based service where they go into the cafe or they go to the bodega or they go into the nursing home or wherever it is that they're going to try and build those services. We must invest and continue to invest in the kinds of staffing that can do that kind of work, and also be very aware of, again, this idea that the same problem areas that cost a lot of money are also some of the most effective kinds of places where you can save money down the road. So we are very cautious about what can be happening to these very small community-based programs that may be so specialized they're going to have a harder time competing in some of these changing models. But one thing to keep in mind is that when we're doing that, and for the folks in the room, when you're looking at DSRIP, if you're looking at PPSs and partnering with them, they may not have the volume, but they have the ability to get at communities that you would have a harder time accessing. So they're very good at accessing those particular communities. And we have to think of them not just that they're small, but what is their particular niche that they can do. And then my job is to help them partner with you and other folks to try and get them to that point. But we need to understand that it's this idea of population health and also looking in a much broader picture. So I think I'm going to stop there because to hand it over to my colleagues on the rest of the panel.
Great. I think, your point earlier saying that, you're the population that everyone looks to that says, oh, this is the high cost, high acuity population. But the fact of the matter is that those services are really needed and they get found in a variety of different places. So Dr. Pasternak, tell us a little bit about how the ACA is, the Trump administration policies might impact primary care in your world.
Well, and I'll actually also talk about how it affects the hospital. Because one of the things that it's had a huge impact on for us is to cause a realization of how much hospital and primary care are intertwined. And they become more and more inextricably bound in a good way over the last 8 to 10 years, which is a good thing. It's a good thing that's at risk as things are changing. To kind of put this in perspective, from the hospitals, there are 5,000 hospitals in the country. About just under 6% of them are what you would call critical access institutions. Those 6% of hospitals have 30% of the burn units, 60% of the burn units, 35% of the behavioral health beds, a disproportionate number of the types of interventions that people need. They train a disproportionate number of physicians, nurses, and other healthcare providers who go out into the community or stay in hospitals as well. And this is the safety net that we have for the population at risk. The patients who go to these hospitals are overwhelmingly having their care paid for by Medicare and Medicaid. So you look at what these hospitals face, and they can have 50 would be a low percentage, 60, 70 or more percent of the care they provided is coming from a government source. And a small tweak in Medicare or Medicaid has a huge impact on these institutions. And to get an idea of the impact, overall operating margins, and I'm going to sound like an administrator here, but this is relevant. Overall, hospitals in this country have a margin of about 5%. That's all in. These hospitals have a margin of minus 1.5%. You take away DSH, it's minus 12%. So these are institutions that serve the population at risk that are very much on the edge. And they could be anything from a major urban institution to hospitals in upstate New York that may be the only hospital in the county. And if that hospital, which is losing money now, goes away, you lose the health fabric and social fabric of an entire community. So this is part of what we're seeing potentially at stake here as we're talking about Medicaid and Medicare changes. And what might seem a small change in Washington is a huge change for these people. It's a change for the people in the community. It's a change for the people who are managing these hospitals. What has happened over the course of the last 10 years has been something that's been long overdue. And that's been a realization on the part of hospitals, not all, I'd like to say most, maybe not quite that, but many hospitals and health systems, that the role of the hospital has to be expanded, that it is part of a health continuum. It is not the center of the universe of health care. And that what primary care does is really provide the care for the community and serves as the barrier that keeps people from needing acute care services. It serves as the place that people go to if they have to be in a hospital to be sure that they don't come back again. There's even a financial penalty if they do, if they come back within 30 days of being discharged. So there's a focus there that says you don't just wheel somebody out, say goodbye, and hope they get readmitted. The whole concept of we're not here to churn people through hospitals has been changing fundamentally. And here it's been changing in ways such as the DSRIP initiative and other initiatives. My colleague Joel MNT is leading that at Stony Brook. And getting people to the idea that health is the community concept. A hospital is part of a community, and it's becoming less and less the focus of where things should be. It more is more of what is going on out in the outer world. The way we reduce infant mortality has a lot more to do with primary care for the expectant mother than it does with the nature of the machines that we have. Reduction in trauma has more to do with the safety of the community than all the wonderful technology that we have in our area. We have 14% of families nutritionally at risk in this country. That's where money should be going to, and that's what's threatened as these initiatives are getting sacrificed in these budget measures, and that's what these are. These are budget measures, not health measures. So from our perspective, we're seeing people trying to back away from a responsibility for health care. The government wants to limit money. Businesses want to limit money, and then, in many instances, leave the health system to try and make those decisions. Now, I also say the realization from our perspective is that it's when we talk about limited funds, we know there's only so much that a public entity has to spend. We can't raise taxes and expect to grow and get jobs for the community. We can't constantly put the burden on somebody else to try and find a way to expand our part of the pie on this thing. So part of what we're seeing now is as we develop the value-based purchasing, as we say, instead of adding beds, you add to the community endeavor, we're seeing that philosophy being put at risk because if we pull back now the way the new legislation has us pulling, the message that is coming to us is this is yet another foray into trying to change the healthcare system that is being put on the shelf and that is going to go away if you just wait it out. And that is what many people are thinking. From the standpoint of care in the community, if you're concerned about disparities in healthcare, this is one of the biggest risks that's leading to disparities. People, physicians, institutions are deciding to opt out of taking care of people who are on Medicare and Medicaid, because from their perspective, it's just not worth the aggravation. I have problems with that decision, but that is the perspective that people have. So now you go to a two-tiered system of people who say, I don't take care of public insurance patients. Some of them don't even take care of private insurance patients, but say, I can fill my office with people who can pay cash. The rest of it has to settle itself. That's not my problem. And that's a problem which has been growing and has the potential for accelerating unless we make the proper investment, which has been made with the Affordable Care Act, in terms of at least recouping part of the cost of having people go through innovation and new perspectives. So when we talk about what is the good out there, and Jim was saying, what's the good news? So Jim, I'll say again, the good news is people and systems have been responding. There are initiatives out there that have been having success. There are track records of achievement that can serve as models for the community. And to put that at risk now, to pull the rug out from under it, which is what this law is going to do, would really be an extreme misfortune that we would look back on now, years from now, and go, what an opportunity that was missed. So I'm going to stop there. I have more to say, but I'll wait for a question to spark it.
Okay. So, Senator Hahn, you're our
thanks. Bob, good evening. Thank you for having this. It's very wonderful. At the beginning, I'll just say that I've just called the AHCA poor public policy. Just blanket that. So there's no entertaining that at all. And in New York, and I just want to talk about what we're doing, we have about 6.4 million people, New Yorkers, on Medicaid. That's about a third of our state. Now, that's not actually that astronomical, because other states, I looked, checked around, some red, some blue, they have about a third of their population on Medicaid also. So this is a big part of the healthcare delivery system, not only in New York, but nationally. And we have a number of things at risk. We have the very basic subsidies, which are a lot. Then we have what's called the basic health plan, or the essential health plan, which was an option given to states to opt into. New York is one of two that opted into it. It's worth $1 billion a year in round numbers, give or take 100 million. That's an outlier if they start to decide to pare down on their expenditures. We also heavily use graduate medical education, so they may want to take a look at that. Deborah already mentioned the bump we get for CHIP. I'm not just worried about the bump. I'm worried about CHIP. There's no one saying that they're committed to renewing CHIP. Big, big deal for America. So there are some real, real problems if we do deal with this. We have not made concrete public plans in New York, though I keep saying we should in private, because we don't want to encourage Washington to make it them seem like we know what we could do that. But we're also, and I've used the phrase, it's like playing basketball in the dark. You don't know how to make public policy when you're not sure what's going to happen. Just today, I read three or four articles contradicting each other. Two from the White House, one the president, the second is budget director, to get them on the same page, a couple from the House of people who are chairs. So we're playing basketball in the dark, but we're rightfully fearful because of all of that. During the budget negotiations that we just completed Sunday night, directly had long discussions with the governor, who wanted unfettered power to make whatever cutbacks he felt deemed desirable in the event of federal cutbacks. It was negotiated back to this. He gets a power to recommend cuts that are equal and proportionate across the Medicaid spectrum. if the cuts to New York are greater than $850 million per year. And he has to make that plan public. The legislature is given 90 days to come up with a counter plan, both houses. And if we do not do that, then his plan goes into effect. That power ends at the end of the new fiscal year, which would be March 31st, 2018. The whole thing, you say, well, you still gave the governor a lot of power. What I really did was make sure that his plan is public, that people will be looking at what happens, able to comment, and if it's egregious, the legislature will act. If it's really egregious, my confidence would be he would amend his plan. So I think that that's about as good a public policy we can get when we don't know where the arrows will fall. A couple of other things. The Capitol. You mentioned that $75 million going to community-based organizations. Let me give you a sense of the numbers. In the prior year's budget, that would be the 17-18, we appropriated $195 million on a formula basis, transformation type of grants, also to hospitals and all other healthcare entities, including community-based organizations. That was not awarded. I raised a big stink about that, so we had a lot of discussions. In this year's budget that was adopted, we added $500 million to that pool. And in the course of discussions, obtained a commitment from the administration that the 195 from last year and 300 of the 500 will be awarded together by the end of this month or the 1st of May, whatever. And that will be statewide, meet the criteria that's in the statute, and I think address a number of the problems that we have, which are myriad in this state. Before we even deal with cutbacks from Washington, we have a lot of problems. Dr. Pasternak mentioned a few of those, but they continue on. And one of the biggest ones, member of the audience, my old friend Don Askenazy, we're helping health and hospitals, or H plus H, whatever they're calling themselves. It's one of the biggest problems we have in the city, which is the 11 public hospitals, which provide the primary, not the use of primary care, but a main source of care in the city. And if they have problems, which they do, I think the last estimate is $500 million a year deficit. In fact, their first quarter was even worse than that, and that was just in a quarter. If they have problems, then the rest of the healthcare system in the city and the surrounding areas have major problems. So we have a lot of work to do besides worrying about what Washington may do to change things around. There's lots of other things. Deborah, since you left, we have the wonderful thing called the Medicaid redesign team. That's driven everybody crazy. We have DSHRP that's added to the paranoia, the craziness, and spent a lot of times in meetings. But those are actually the germ of changes. The innovation plan, et cetera. There are some major changes taking place. However, I get to the end of it simply by saying it's not all value-based payment. For some entities that are delivering health care, they can do it. A large, well-organized, well-run hospital, a well-run major doctor practice, a well-run clinic, that's fine. But that's not probably even 50% of the care that gets delivered in this state. It's the other 50% that I'm not sure are capable of adopting to value-based payment. So really, I've been kind of dragging my heels, but it's not in statute. And certainly our Medicaid director wanted to put it in statute, and towards the end of the budget process, because I not only do the health budget, but I just do the Medicaid budget, so I get all of the O agencies coming through. What did I find in behavioral health? Oh, they wanted to do something that was value-based. And then they came back and they described value-based without saying value-based. We changed it because we have to be able to operate as we go forward and do reforms. So it's an interesting dynamic, and I'm sure we'll revisit it down the road. So those are just my comments. It doesn't totally agree with what's going to happen with Obamacare, but whatever. Thank you.
Well, so thank you. I mean, I think you're right that the what's happened with the Affordable Care Act is not the only thing that New York or other states are facing, and so we have to manage all of this at the same time, which I think is a really complicated set of things. So between all of us up here, I think we've raised an enormous number of issues. So I'm just going to kick off the conversation with a couple questions, but first I just want to, so I want to start back a little bit, going back to the Affordable Care Act, if we can do that. And just say, you know, a hallmark of the Republican platform has been that Obamacare is, you know, horribly broken, hugely expensive, non-competitive, fundamentally flawed, and about to implode. Aside from the fact of the subsidies, which we know is in fact one of the big issues that could make it implode, but that is a manufactured situation. You know, what are we talking about? Why has the Affordable Care Act, which we all have described here as really supporting fundamental health care for a third or more of our state, you know, why is it created such a huge uproar?
If Hillary had won, we'd be talking about reforming Obamacare. I never got into that because as soon as you got into it, you got into people feeling you're talking politics. And frankly, I'd rather talk health policy. But there were things, narrow networks, high deductibles, availability of competing plans. One of the things you talked about, the importance of treating the mom. Do you know that it took us a real amount of state hissy fit to make sure we covered a pregnant woman, because until we got the rule changed, she could only be covered under Obamacare in the event she delivered, which was like, wait a minute, this doesn't make any sense whatsoever. And you say, well, how did that happen? Well, it turned out that you had to pick a model plan to use for your silver plan when you're picking plans under Obamacare, and the model plan the state had picked was an Oxford plan that didn't cover women just because they were pregnant. So we had to amend that somehow and get allied by it. So there were a lot of things that were there. I think the high cost was a big problem. But the next problem was, what was going to happen with the Cadillac tax? That was going to be a major vehicle for future financing. And to talking to labor, talking to business, people hated it, so there was going to need to be something to substitute for that. But that's all theoretical. We're really now back down to probably, if they do the things they want to do in Washington, what do we do to make sure we have a viable healthcare system in New York that protects as many people as possible? And I think that's going to be a really difficult chore to do.
I very much agree with everything Senator Hannan said, and so we
should scare everybody.
I know, really. Now you really have to worry. I think the issue is the Affordable Care Act is trying to make 17% of the GDP work better. We couldn't get it right away. I mean, it was no matter who did it, we knew we had to go back and change it. And the problem was the political environment didn't allow for the rational conversation. So, you know, the fact that a number of plans pulled out around the country and that there are markets with only one plan left, you know, that's been used to say it's a failure. It's a problem. On the other hand, I do a lot of work in southern states where there is only one plan. There was one plan before the ACA and there's one plan now. So, you know, everything can't be blamed on the ACA. We have to be able to have that rational discussion. And one of the other reasons is guaranteed issue. The ACA said insurers can no longer deny coverage. This wasn't an issue in New York. Didn't work well, but it wasn't an issue in New York. Can no longer deny coverage because you have an illness, because you had cancer, because you have diabetes. Well, for most insurers, that was a radical change. So the Affordable Care Act provided for risk insurance for some number of years to help insurers. I know we don't talk about helping insurers, but when we're changing the risk pool, well, then Congress, as a political act, said we're no longer going to have the risk adjusters. So everything has a push and a pull, and trying to model healthcare, so I come back to what Kim said, in a political environment just isn't doable. So how do we get past it and make the changes we need to?
I think one other thing that we didn't talk that much about was this idea of the, you know, the individual mandate. So this idea that everyone needed insurance, which at the and would have a penalty for it. So clearly this was one of the ways in which the to try to get the younger, healthier folk into the insurance market, which they were not in because that was the demographic that isn't covered necessarily by employer insurance as much. And I think that that was another piece of it. But so what's going to happen? There's a new rule that was dropped today, right? What's going to happen with the individual mandate and the, you know, all the things that go along with that?
Well, you want does anyone else?
I don't need to go first and I'll follow you.
No, you go first because I could talk too much easily.
So I wasn't listening to the news today. I didn't know it was dropped today, but it goes to prove if you make a statement about what's happening in Washington, at some point you'll be right on. So what we see with the individual mandate is, and it's very clear what's going to happen. People will opt out. If you look at first dollar that people spend it on food, shelter, utilities, phone, entertainment, student loans. And I think there's always this sense that if I get sick, somehow it will be taken care of. There's always somebody, someplace I can go, and it will be done. And by and large, they're right. So they'll get someplace where somebody won't turn them away. The care will be provided either because it's required legally or because ethically somebody takes that up as something to do. And that cost will be incurred. But what's the cost that's incurred? You treat a person for stroke instead of giving them their antihypertensive medication. And they don't get their cancer picked up at an early point. And these are not hypothetical situations. These are the realities that we deal with that I think many people just don't have in the front of their mind in their day-to-day lives. So I'm truly concerned that the walking well will opt out. They're financially stretched. They can't afford it, or that just is low on the priorities. But the care will be provided, but too little, too late, in a system that's very fragmented.
Okay, so we have a mic. Jonathan, where are you with the mic? Do we have the mic someplace? No.
I bet.
Laura, can you get the mic for the audience? But we'll get started here. Don, why don't you?
The quality of these presentations was extraordinary beyond anything I could have ever imagined. So we can't.
To Washington now.
I mean, I can't thank you for the quality of this discussion. It's just been extraordinary. And each had its own component. But what I wanted to do was take this last discussion, because I've been saying to myself, we need to enhance Obamacare. That's what you're all talking about. And I don't know whether the politics would ever permit that to emerge, but if we could put together a bill that enhanced Obamacare in meeting the needs of the population that you're talking about, what the shortcomings are, could that weigh in against what the Republicans are trying to do? And I don't know whether we have time to do that, but I just think it would strengthen the value of Obamacare if we could mitigate those issues. So I'm hoping that if you all thought that made sense, you would talk to Chuck Schumer about it, try and get his attention.
So I think that it's a great question. I think certainly one of the things that we're going to have to do is not call it Obamacare, but I do think that that a new snappy name is necessary. Any of you want to take on what we could do to improve on what we've currently got rather than tear it down?
I think that's always a great idea. I think there are some people who have left the administration who have been trying to do a little bit of that to be that voice. But I think one thing that I would want to push back on is, as we talked about, it's not necessarily about what we're talking about, which is making sure that we have community care and a continuous system of care. I think the assumption, perhaps, and I'm being a little negative here, is that if the goal is to save money and to allow people tax breaks who don't need affordable health care, then that's it doesn't matter what plans the smartest group and the people in this room come up with, because that's not going to happen. If they're looking to save money and give middle class tax breaks or upper class tax breaks and things like that, we can't come up with any plan. So I think we have to be clear about what we're fighting and where we're starting. And I know that's a little bit of a controversial point of view, but when we talk about that we're taking money from a health system that 74 million people have in this country, and giving tax breaks to people who can afford other kinds of health care, and we're hearing the stories of people not taking insurance, only private pay, I think we have to have a hard discussion about, is this really about reforming, or is there some other philosophical view about what we should be providing as a safety net in this country? So I know it's a little controversial, but I feel like somebody has to say it.
So
hi, my name's Lowell Feldman. I was a provider for about 40 years in the state and recently retired. Senator Hannon knows me well. I have a question, and it's inevitable there's going to be cuts, regardless of whose party and what the name of the bill is going to be. So I'm wondering how we can be proactive, and what your feelings are on that, to recognizing there are going to be cuts and what we can do about it. Personally, having dealt with a DOH and OMH and OASIS in my career, and I'm still on New Horizons board, and still active in a way, the regulations are very expensive. And each one of our components, DOH, OMH, OASIS, has conflicting regulations. I'll give an example. Dennis is getting into telemedicine. I'm into telemedicine. DOH, OMH, and OASIS are developing three different sets of regulations for New York State, all of them in draft form. And I spoke to DOH this week, and they said after 25 revisions, and they haven't come up with one, why do we need regulations? And it's making more stringent. And it's not just in participation in things like telehealth, but it's also in the payment. The other aspect is education. And we need to focus on educating health. We educate college graduates, getting out, doing all types of things in the business world, but starting especially areas like Bronx and Sullivan County, the two worst counties in the state of New York, and I've been in both of them frequently and forever. The education has to start with, as you mentioned, the Latino families who are drinking Gatorade for startups. They got diabetes by the time they're nine. And that is lacking seriously. And then there's also a mindset that needs to be changed, because the majority of health spending is in the last 3 years of life? And I think we have to re-educate Americans on palliative care, and when it's time to go, time to go. And that, again, won't solve the budget problems, but it'll be a proactive approach to how you can deal with some of the cuts. So I'm wondering what your opinions are on all those three topics: education, regulation, and mindset.
I'm not letting you talk to a family of an elderly father.
I only took care of him for how many years?
All right. So let's start with one that, I don't know, maybe the easiest one, the regulatory framework. In New York State, we have a regulatory framework for healthcare, for mental health care, and for substance use disorders. Any thoughts on if this is an issue, funding issue?
In the middle of the budget proposal by the governor, there was a thing that called for modernization of regulations. And the person who is a source of all that is a very skilled bureaucrat who had a really substantial reason for putting that in. Budget office developed it into this budget proposal. He just wanted to deal with nursing homes and hospitals. But it was like an inkblot test. The amount of people who objected to that because they thought it was aimed at something they had a vested interest in was incredible. So three agencies developing a reg on the same topic, that's what happens. We simply have to use a knife to cut through the Gordian knot that is the regulations. At one point, I said we should get rid of all of the CON provisions in regard to construction, not the character and fitness, but the construction. I said because, and this was two years ago after the recession, there's no one there to approve these plans. It's taking forever, it's costing money. The department agreed with me, but instead of agreeing to do away with the CON for construction, they hired three architects.
So
there you go.
I can't make it up.
So any other, I mean, I think that this is one of the places where certainly as we're thinking about new forms of care and how do we do exactly what you're talking about, Dr. Pasternak, which is try to serve people at the front end before they actually have to get to the emergency room or the hospital or the inpatient setting for a psychiatric episode. What we want to do is make sure that when someone walks in a door, that whether that door is their behavioral health provider or whether that door is their primary care provider, that they get what they need and that that's sort of their medical home. And I think that the regulatory framework should follow that. Unfortunately, I think that we are in a situation where the regulations preclude some of that from happening, and I think we have to work a little faster to modernize, whether we put it in legislation or not.
I don't know if you're going to speak to this too, but I think there's a couple areas. One is with how we do, speaking to the idea of integration. So one is how do we integrate a physical health clinic with a behavioral health clinic? And so, or even how do you integrate a substance use and mental health clinic? How those regulations are in conflict. And then if you add a physical health clinic, there's a whole other thing. But then there's the other piece of, and I absolutely agree, and I think we continue to struggle. And I know for those of you who have clinics, I know that's something that we're trying, even just what does the waiting room look like, or what does your linen closet look like? Well, we don't have a linen closet because we've never had a linen closet in our mental health clinic, but we'll get one. Or, you know, do we have the...
2007, when I came in, I tried to align mental health and physical health regulations and reimbursement, and it's great to know you're still working on it.
So I think there's that piece of it, and then there's the payment piece, because that's the, you know, for our clinic operator, the people in the room who are doing this, there's the piece that it should be seamless, that there's no wrong door, that people come in, you have a nurse practitioner who's checking somebody's blood levels or blood pressure levels or doing blood testing while they go and they have that, and then they go have their session with somebody. You know, that, and how do you pay for two appointments at the same time? These things get in the way of actually doing these seamless transition things. I don't think they're insurmountable. I think that we can do them, though it's death by 1,000 paper cuts, I think, sometimes. So I'm going to see if you want to weigh in on the clinic side.
I think I do. it's around the physical integration, which then leads, of course, to better integration of care. But I think we've seen a lot of the barriers that are put up by separate entrances for behavioral health versus the primary care, the Article 28 versus the Article 31, and the mix and match. And I think there have been some improvements in that, and in some of our operations people would say, yes, there have been. But they're in participating in some special MAX projects this last year, we found that there was no interest in looking at the financing model that follows the integrative model. And I think that even in the rollout of DSRIP, we've been working for now about 2.5 years, and someone will correct me on that, Jim. 2.5 years with our behavioral health, with an IPA of behavioral health providers. We formed an IPA. They had an IPA. We tried to put it together. This preceded DSRIP. It preceded attribution of the patient through the primary care system. Now, that, to our advantage, it was the patient came our way. But in a way, we could not value, and we still are trying to work on the modeling of how do we value the attribution or the behavioral health component in this now joint IPA venture. 50-50. We're not trying to say, well, we're 70% of it and you're worth 30. But it is really complicated because you follow the funds flow and you can't figure it out because not very many people have figured it out. We've looked in Massachusetts, we've looked in Oregon, we've looked in other Washington State. Other places are starting to place, and my ears picked up when someone was talking about the value-based payment model with an integrative footprint or foundation, as I was saying, that community health centers really want to take a stab at building the foundation of the primary care system with our behavioral health partners, with others who link together, make a difference in the cost of care and in the quality and the access. And that until you write the system to have the primary care system be the receiver of those patients from all different angles in a coordinated network and then push them, one cannot even work up the premium chain to be able to get an influence the outcomes of emergency room use together, and the inpatient and the discharge planning and all the things that were put at, we would like to be put at risk for in the transformation process, which is ultimately a total cost of care model, we're still not there in having everybody aligned. And I think starting with behavioral health. That's right. And so the health home has a variety of different, certainly dependence on and wanting to work more and more with our care management agencies, but having the same issue of collaboration. And Jim, you probably could just stand up and add to this because I cannot. I get lost in the subject. You run it, so at some point.
You know, I think that the regular... Right. Well, no. Sorry, okay. So I think the regulatory framework is as you point out, sort of only one piece of the puzzle, right? You've got financing, you've got physical plant, you've got the regulatory framework, and then I think you've got the whole question about this idea of no wrong door. So where a patient comes, where someone comes into and where they get most of their services should be their home, whether it's an FQHC or whether it's a behavioral health center. And the question is, how do we make it much more, how to make it easier for that person then to get the other services either on site or by referral through that place where they are, where the majority of their care is being taken care of. And I think we don't quite have that figured out. We have very different payment systems and very different regulations, but.
Well, what we have is a problem with getting that person because you don't build it and they'll come. What we have is a problem with who have multiple problems, health, mental health, substance abuse, and that's what the health home is all about. And what HRH is doing was one of the most successful models in health homes in the state. In fact, maybe the only successful model, but it's improving rapidly because unless we deal with those problems, those are the 10% of the population that's driving 70 and 80% of the cost. And they're not just going to come. You have had great models for the regular health care, the regular clinics. The hospital has great outpatients moving the needle as to where the primary amount of care is going. But until we get the folks who don't want to show up and say, it's good you can show up. We're not going to do anything harmful to you. We'll take care of you. Then, and hopefully this will all work out.
So I want to just come back on this because this is an issue that really bugged me when I walked in as Medicaid director in 2007. And I'm serious when I started to look at alignment. And at that point, one of the issues was the O agencies, right? Because the Medicaid director had responsibility for physical health. The commissioner of mental health had mental health, and then there was substance abuse. So we had three different agencies, three different commissioners. And, it didn't work. And so I want to suggest, as in terms of alignment and integration, the kinds of things that you've done with your health home, the kinds of things you were talking about. And so I want to suggest, and it goes to the regulatory point as well, is that when government itself is siloed, physical health, mental health, substance abuse, then we had managed care plans where substance abuse, in my day, it finally got put in, was pulled out. We can't create the system with the one door. So we still have three agencies here. We still, we've moved our managed care. I just finished a paper and a study for a Commonwealth Fund on Arizona, where the governor and the Medicaid director moved all of it under the Medicaid director. And we interviewed every stakeholder. And they're changing reimbursement. They're changing regulations. They've got a ways to go. But it's really exciting. So my point on this one is we ought to be starting at the top with our government agencies and working our way down to create the infrastructure that enables what you're talking about.
What you started still is rolling out, but it's gotten more and more concentrated each year.
Okay, so take another question over here.
How you doing? So I'm Gary Jacobs, and I'm on the board of PCDC, and I work in the post-acute space, and I want to talk about something else, though. I've been through the negotiations and discussions in D.C. I live in D.C. I don't even know where I am right now, but I'm here. It took a long time. It's $100 Uber. But anyway, here's what I want to say and what you guys to think about and then respond to potentially. So during the negotiations around the Affordable Care Act, and Don, the issue on Obamacare versus the Affordable Care Act is huge right now because of the optics. It's just like repeal and replace is moving to repeal and revise, or repeal and another R word. And we're going to find that. And that's what Paul Ryan and his guys are trying to figure out. But that's not my question. My question is that this involved in Obamacare the Affordable Care Act did not just increase coverage as its only solution to health care challenges. It was creating payment reform and health delivery reform. So as you think about that issue, there's an obligation inherent in that structure to do value-based care in a way that begins to align the interest between providers and payers and to move the needle some way down. So what I heard, and I'm only being provocative, I'm not trying to be argumentative, is that the way it's been is the way it's always been, and if you gave us more money, and if you take that away, we're going to not be able to deliver on our responsibility and our promise. Under the environment in D.C. that I live in every day when I'm in that town, which is not, my wife would say, not very often, but the truth be, the providers have to step up and work in a value-based environment and go to their managed care plans. Medicaid primarily is a managed care play now in most states in this country. And you have to come back to them with solutions around how you can do this better, I believe, and that would be my contention. In post-acute care, we've got to work with skilled nursing facilities that have been fee-for-service based for so long, and their whole payment model is now under revision, as well as home care. And we have to come up with a solution that has them buy in. So we go to payers and say, we'll do that on a fully risk basis and manage your patient once they just discharge from a hospital. So I love you, and I love what you talk about all the time that I see you, and I love what the organization does. Truth is, FQHCs and their payment system has got to change. Disproportionate hospitals and what they do, you got to love what they do. I've worked in Billings, Montana, in Cheyenne, Wyoming. I was a PwC consultant for a long time. And what I learned is that healthcare has to change all the time, and we have to be part of that change. The Affordable Care Act gives you the opportunity to do that change. And even in New York, you really created innovation funds and innovation models. Are you using them? Are they or what are you doing to move the needle? Because you have a responsibility, is my provocative challenge to you.
So I guess the key question is, can we move that fast to total risk, total cost of care? What are the barriers? What, you know, is the Affordable Care Act the facilitator for that? Are there other facilitators that are necessary?
I'm just going to say something really quickly. The answer is possibly yes, but the tragedy is that we are now spending our time defending the Affordable Care Act and not improving it and not using the platform that the Affordable Care Act gave us and the work that was in place, starting, not anywhere near, to do the value-based payment. We had the coverage model and we could move forward. Instead of improving the coverage model or moving forward on the value-based payment, I'm now spend 90% of my time trying to save the minimum we got under the Affordable Care Act. So now you can give a more positive.
I don't know if I can, except that I did propose when I was talking with you all that we're at a stage where we need to be in value-based payment and participating with an alternative methodology. And I think that timing is everything. And it takes, it has been an evolution from the time, the decade, over the last decade, where the realization that some other model of the way we are reimbursed will incent and will help to realign the system. And I just wanted to say that I think performance is something we shouldn't have ever undervalued. But I can remember when Mark Chasson was Commissioner of Health in New York State, that he kept talking about quality and nobody paid attention to him. Quality was what his thing was, and they'd have interviews and pictures, and you know, people kind of read it, but they didn't get it. And I think, how long was that ago? I mean, 20 years? I don't remember. 15? I've been around for 40, so I can't figure that one out, but in that span of time. 1993. Really, that quality and the perform and measuring performance and moving to outcomes is something that people are just getting a hold of. And I had to speak for, it was a short panel discussion before the county board of legislators, the health committee here in Suffolk, not too long ago, to talk about the impact of what we had under the Affordable Care Act and where we may head with the AHCA. And I gave an example that our medical director gave to me as an example, so I could be a little off in all of this. But the bottom line is we, HRH Care, saved 313 lives in 2016 by controlling, by increasing the rate of controlled hypertensives by 20% above the national benchmark. And in that, when you apply all the numbers to and the percentages, we saved 313 lives by a patient coming into our community health center site, being seen a minimum, there are criteria, 4 times. This is a Medicaid patient, 4 times. And when you don't have insurance, guess what our number is? It is 4 under Medicaid. Our patients visit 2 times if they're uninsured. Under the Affordable Care Act, under the Essential Health Plan, they visit 3 times. But part of making that happen, the improvement, is in gearing your whole organization to improvement. And the whole environment has to be improvement of the quality and the performance. That's what guides us.
So,
CFOs in the quality meetings now?
My CFO has never not been in the quality meetings.
So just to add a little bit on to what Ann said, because I agree with everything she said, I think it'd be a shame if we let the initiative pass to somebody else and didn't seize it. The solution to this is not going to come from CMS. The solution is going to come from the people who provide care and who take the initiative to do it. And that's what has been missing a lot in all this and coming up with those solutions. And I think we're past the point where we can do it in incremental steps, see how it works for a couple of years, take another step and see how it works for a couple of years, because the gap is getting wider faster than those incremental steps are doing it. The public's not happy with the system. The government's not happy with the system. Employers aren't happy with the system. And we're still taking small steps. So I think it's going to take something bold. And it's going to be something that is going to force change, and force change that a lot of our colleagues are going to actively fight. But I'd rather that fight be within us to have the design generated by us going forward. And I think the desire is there for it. The other impetus for that is that Apple, Google, Amazon, TripAdvisor, there's a whole group of people waiting on the periphery of healthcare who just want to jump in because they see how we're doing it and they're thinking they can do it better. And some of them probably can. So I think the time is now for us to really do it. And we've got an extraordinary number of creative people in healthcare, and I think we need to turn them loose and support them.
Tonight was invaluable. And when you made the point about the hospitals can no longer be the center of the universe, they need to be strategic partners with the physician delivery system, that's a key element of the transformation that can take place under value-based payment. And I know we're preoccupied with the Affordable Care Act, but the value-based payment initiative opportunity is the most important transformative event in healthcare because it changes the economic incentives from fee-for-service medicine to having the providers effectively be the insurers and transform the care and focus on the health of the population.
And the place where it's going on is under the DSHRP initiative, which supposedly has been signed on for another 5 years from Washington. It's a contract, so I don't know if they can adversely affect that. And that's what's driving as much value-based payment as anything else in this state. Although there are a few insurers, like Emblem, who said they want to initiate it themselves.
Kemp,
but
you
can't do it without coverage. I mean, I hate to be the downer here, but I agree with all of this. This is really inspiring. But at the bottom, at the end of the day, it's value-based payment. If I don't have coverage, you don't have payment.
Right, and I think that gets to your point that, I mean, there's a couple of things that we're having to deal with as a society, right? So people, we have risk populations that are unlikely to get payment and to get coverage. Then who are the people that are going to be serving those people? And it comes back to how do you value a service that you've never gotten paid for, which is the point that I'm talking about. There's a cultural dissonance to the safety net, which has always picked up the payment for things that they were never going to get paid for, and they went above and beyond it. And so I love your point about DSHRP, and I think that's the vehicle. But I want to say to our friends out there that 1% of the DSHRP dollars have flowed to the community-based organizations. We can't do it without those dollars, without those innovations, because again, it's not that we don't want to do it, is we need those same innovative consultants you're working with, the software, we need the dashboards, we need to be looking at what can we do to really know about our data, because right now there's information asymmetry. We have not as a sector been able to collect it, not for not wanting to, but one, we haven't been funded to do it in the way that we need to do it going forward. I think we have to look at new funding models, but we need the resources to do that. I don't think anybody disagrees with that part. But there has to be more transparency about, and I love what you talk about transparency, because you have to have transparency of all the partners. And my big piece around the DSHRP is that we have to have a stronger partnership. And I think now, to the point of being optimistic, everything is at risk right now. And I'm not talking about payment model risk. I'm talking about everything's at risk, so that if I and the rest of you in this room aren't coming together looking at all the people who are part of PPSs really being full partners, being fully engaged, because my members are parts of multiple PPSs, haven't received a dime, haven't, more importantly though, they haven't benefited from the affiliation of the knowledge of the hospitals and the healthcare systems who have a lot more experience doing this. And I would say now is the opportunity. We cannot lose this opportunity, and everybody has to understand that so much is at risk, even with another 5 years.
And DSHRP is a godsend because it's the enabler of the transformation that we're hoping will take place.
So I think that's right, but I also want to caution that I don't think that DSHRP has quite yet lived up to the promise. And I
that's
think
why if we have a panel discussion,
right,
it could be informative to the larger community about how we can get where we need to go.
So I think that's right. I'm gonna do the wrap up now because I think we're at that moment. And then we actually encourage everyone. There's going to be some wine and cheese, and we encourage everyone to continue this conversation. Some of it can be done up here, but some of it can certainly be done and should be done all across our organizations. But I think I want to start back with this concept that the Affordable Care Act was supposed to be a floor and a beginning of full coverage for all of us so that we could get the system, that we could get the money into healthcare at the right place, at the right time for patients. It didn't live, it wasn't able to do all of that perfectly. There were a lot of things that didn't quite happen, yet that was, I think, the original intention. And so needing to make sure that those funds, those huge dollar amounts don't get pulled out of our system, which will really have an adverse effect, is I think quite important. But I do want to sort of point out some of the things that people said here, which is, first of all, if we see that money pulling out, we will see a greater competition among healthcare providers as opposed to the coordination and collaboration that is required for improving outcomes, what gets called value-based payment, but what is really about total care for individuals and for communities that is adequately reimbursed. And I would argue that's actually what we're looking for. And that if we actually see that the concentration of services that are paid for by Medicaid, whether it's the FQHCs, the safety net hospitals, the behavioral health system, the primary care providers, what we know now is that those are the folks with the thinnest margin today. And so they're the ones who actually need the base payment in order to make sure that they're actually able to fulfill that promise. So I would argue that sometimes the rubric of value-based payment is used by many to say, after you do the work, we'll pay you. But we actually have to figure out a way to say there's a floor. There's a floor that you must get paid for to keep your doors open. And then you pile on top of that quality bonuses or total cost of care bonuses or whatever you want. But if you remove that, the safety net, I would argue, and primary care in particular, will actually cease to exist. And I think that's the fundamental concern that we have about this sort of we'll pay you afterwards thing. When you prove to us that primary care really works, you know, that it really can keep people out of the hospital, that it can keep hypertensives safe, and it can deal with, you know, our sort of the high acuity patients and folks in our community who need a lot of care. We have to actually make sure that the floor is there. I would argue that if we lose coverage for the many people that potentially could lose coverage, that we lose the subsidies, that we increase the barriers to getting care, that will land us back in a place where, in fact, we will have the need for only acute care services. Those will get reimbursed as the services of last resort, and we will now be back in that setting. So I think we have to argue very carefully and fully that we need those services and we need that payment up front. I think that the philosophy of making sure that our communities are healthy and adequate payment for it is really what we're arguing for, whether we say it's primary care, behavioral health, the safety net hospitals, that we know that these are the folks with a track record of achievement that has been, and that we have to now move from let's prove it, oh, you have to prove to me again that you can do this, like stop doing that, but now actually start building those payment models that say we'll pay for your basic expenses and for the quality that you provide. We've talked a little bit about the regulatory framework and how we need to think about changing the regulatory framework to enhance our ability to serve people as whole people wherever they walk in addition to making sure that those who don't walk in are actually found and brought into the system through whatever door they're found, whether it's through the behavioral health system or through the primary care system. I actually don't care. I just want, once there, to actually get them into care. And then I think what we have to talk a little bit about is how do we make sure that that all of these services that are really the frontline services are really reimbursed adequately in a way that today they just fundamentally are not. Even if all the perfect, you know, the perfect world with DSRIP or anything else, the fundamental point is that our services in the safety net are actually not yet reimbursed adequately, and we need to do that. So I think that's the beginning of the conversation, certainly not the end. I want to thank all of you for your enormous contributions tonight and to everything that you do every day in the world, and to thank all of you for being here.